Hello everyone, it's Damon with MVTV, and we're here for another night of live stream. And I just wanted to talk about the combination of NLP and MBTI. I've kind of teased this over the last month or so, 2 months, and there's a lot of integration with these two systems and understanding how you can use NLP to further improve upon your MBTI type and vice versa. So we're going to discuss the concepts of MBTI and how they relate to NLP and some things that NLP can do to improve your MBTI interactions with other people. Ultimately, we go into MBTI because we have this underlying idea of, hey, I want to better understand myself. I want to further improve myself so that I can improve my relationships with other people or to improve myself and understand why I react to certain people the way I do. Well, with NLP, what we do is we take that concept and we actually make that happen. Because when you go into MBTI, you now understand the functions, but you still suck. You know, you're like, I understand that I'm not reacting or acting the way that I need to be doing. Or maybe it's just me, but I still sucked once I understood MBTI. But at least I had a reason now. I had an idea of why I sucked, but I still didn't have an application. So I've mentioned that MBTI tends to lack that aspect of application quite a bit. So I wanted to make sure that I gave that to you today. So hopefully you guys are going to get some value from this show and we'll go from there. So, all right, let's talk about this concept number one. All right, so if you guys don't know what NLP is, some of you may be returning guests and some of you may not be, but NLP is essentially using a linguistic way of, or using the linguistic manner in programming patterns that are in the mind. So, you know, we can look at this, we can parallel this with the way that the world is. We have the actual world and we have maps of the world. Would anybody say that the map of the world is 100% accurate? Probably not, right? We have people's interpretation, their measurements, the way they draw the territories. They may make mountains higher, lower. You'll see those ones with many contours that have high mountains and low mountains and the little ranges and stuff. And you'll see that they try to image or replace or try to indicate that there's a higher elevation here than there is somewhere else on the map. Well, without getting too much into cartography, NLP is like cartography of the mind. And it's altering the map that you've laid throughout your life experience, which was done unconsciously. So as you went through life, you were laying down this map. You were being a cartographer of your own mind and you were laying down your life experience through the map. And as you did that, you have a certain map of reality. And that map is the layer of how you're seeing reality, which we call filters, and the actual objective reality beneath it. NLP helps you break those patterns of ego, which we've talked about, you know, and it helps make that transition into your deeper self a lot smoother. Because sometimes when you face yourself, you have that friend, like I've mentioned in my loneliness video, you have that friend who tells you something that you already know about yourself, but you're not ready to confront. You can do that and NLP smooths that out. You say, okay, somebody's gonna tell me this because I know that this is visible. So somebody's gonna give me this information and as a result, I'm going to react a certain way because that's how I normally react. So I'm gonna smooth this out by programming my own reaction to this particular experience. This person's saying this one thing. So let's say that you have a fear of a particular person. You have a fear of getting a romantic relationship, or you have a fear of conflict, or you have a fear of being disrespected, or whatever it may be, whatever that fear is, or fear of a job interview, or a fear of dressing professionally, or whatever it may be that you are afraid of doing, you can actually fix that, or at least change your own map of that particular experience in your own mind, so you don't have to deal with all the consequences of that, so that it can smooth that out. That's what NLP is used for as far as it ties into Enneagram. We've talked about that when we go into NLP and Enneagram and altering our own subconscious routines. That being said, I do want to stress the point of NLP as far as it goes with MBTI. So in MBTI, we have a four-function stack. And that four-function stack, now many different MBTI theories that are kind of more Jungian than they are in MBTI talk about the eight function model. You know, like you have the shadow function model. You also have the subset function model. You have different function models for how people theorize how the shadow function is going to play, making it all eight. But in standard MBTI theory, there's four. And they still say you do use the other ones, but it's just, there's no clear distinction of how you use those functions as far as official MBTI nomenclature says. That's what it is. So you have four valued functions, functions that you use, you understand, they make sense. Now, as you get lower, they make less sense, they get more complicated. So your top two is like clear as day. Then your last two or your bottom two are like, oh man, this is rough. I don't know how to deal with this. What does this mean? I need some help in this area. You may recognize that it's still there, but you value it. So you still are open to having help. You are open to receiving information or feedback on those particular areas. So when you look at this valued model and you see what's valued as far as the functions that you understand in your MBTI stack, you can also see how you treat functions that are unvalued, AKA your shadow functions. This is where you get this type conflict between INTP versus ENTJ, right? You get this, well, they use TI and that's a bunch of crap, right? Because it doesn't make sense because I approach the world with TE. So you have a natural predisposition to unvalue things that people lead their lives with. The INTP leads their life with a TI dominant function. They lead their life with this function that goes, that's how they approach the world. And if you don't value that function, how are you going to value that person? It's harder to value that person when you're in a position to, you know, have this preconception that function is less valued. And this is kind of our natural predisposition toward the cognitive psyche, unless you were raised in a way that taught you how to appreciate other people, how to welcome other people, appreciate different perspectives, right? Unless you had life experience that kind of forced change within yourself, where you kind of like, okay, I need to change that, and you did. Understanding that NLP is the tool to be able to alter those subconscious routines. So if we use that example, that's one way. So you get a lot of inner type conflict. So if we think about this, when we compare this to the rival types, which we clarified a while ago, and all to do to calculate your rival type is you flip the middle two letters in your MBTI type. And you're going to get your absolute rival type or conflicting type as far as, and this is not official MBTI theory, of course. This is kind of a mixture of Kersey. But we flip those middle two letters and you realize they use all your unvalued functions and they use your weaker opposing unvalued functions for their primary functions. So you can naturally say how you unvalue and don't understand their way of living at all. Okay, so you have, let's say for me, someone who's ENTJ, you have ESFJ. And they approach the world with FE and SI, which are unvalued in the ENTJ. And not only unvalued, but the feeling and sensing aspect are misunderstood. They're a point of weakness for the ENTJ, and they're like, okay, I don't quite understand this. And they're the opposing attitude. So naturally, you're going to not only value it, but not understand it. So you're probably going to have some conflicts with these people. So if you can understand what's unvalued in that sense, then you can understand, okay, I recognize that I don't get along with these people. For example, last example for this, and I'll let Trey and Daniel butt in real quick, but Daniel posted a video about the INTP relationship love and compatibility, and a lot of people said, ESFJ, oh no, screw ESFJs. Never, they're my mom. Well, your mom found love in her life at some point, and then there you are, right? So it's possible. There's no type bias here. There's no, oh, ESFJs suck, or, you know, I like to poke fun of all types, but ultimately there's no real type bias if you can understand the perspective, right? So INTPs and ESFJs have the same valued functions, but it's opposing and it's opposite. So there's still a lack of understanding. So we have two issues, two central core issues here, understanding and value, right? So do you understand that function and do you value that function? All right, Daniel, Trey, you got anything to add to it real quick?
I think it's actually very interesting because, like, as you were saying, you know, everybody does walk down their own journey. So, you know, whatever conditioning you kind of go through unconsciously, you know, like you're saying in like the INTP ESFJ relationship kind of, you know, a lot of people just kind of seek out different things, and we have the dynamic in which we have our relationships in our life are truly guided by kind of our outward kind of projection of how we kind of feel against the world, right? Like our antennas against like the stimuli that is not us, right? And so if we go through life, like the first portion of our life, constructing a framework in which, you know, an INTP says an ESFJ is really unfavorable, then, you know, it's going to make total sense because this whole time the INTP was just kind of being conditioned not to like that type, even though they might be really compatible. You know, they would, you know, according to like what you're saying, it sounds like they wouldn't be, you know, really, until maybe a later time, compatible even on like a basic level.
Trey?
Yeah, my thoughts about, can you hear me all right?
I can hear you fine.
All right, just making sure. My thoughts about this is that when I make an argument against somebody, and I'm just going to start in a weird place, but when I make an argument against somebody or I propose an idea, I immediately hear like Eric from Talking with Famous People arguing with me. And it really helps me because while I'm coming up with this idea, I am also receiving arguments in my head from different types, right? And so when you see types working in their specialty, what they're very good at, and you're placed in a certain situation, then you can really leverage how those types process information. I'm not saying I could simulate it exactly like they could, but what I do know is that it really helps me refine my ideas and different parts of my life when I can fully understand or at least have a simplified emulation, I guess, of that person and the way that they think. It really helps in like all kinds of different situations. So one thing that I would say is that when it comes to NLP, it seems like when we come across certain people, we start to put up filters against different people and like different programs, meta programs, where we're kind of moving people out of the way and in different directions and stuff, like, oh no, this person's like that, or oh no, this person's like that. But when it comes to MBTI, and if we can like get a decent understanding or a decent perspective of what that person is seeing and what they're contributing, I think it allows us to at least, because you can know about it and you don't have to do anything with it, but you could also go back and think about how you filter these people out of your life and take the perspective that you know now, like this person's really good at this. This is what I wish I had in myself. And if you can recognize that in people, then you can completely redefine the way that you've been filtering people out of your life. And I think that's a really big crossover to where those systems connect.
Yeah, thanks, Trey. And so there's a correlation here, and that's what we're trying to really uncover is how does this all tie in? But I know many of you may feel frustrated with MBTI because once you figure out the cognitive functions, you do your thing and you try to type other people, which you really can't do with MBTI very well. But even then, you're trying to type other people, so you can try to, this is natural because you're trying to improve a relationship dynamic, right? That's what your goal is I want to improve the relationship dynamic and understand why this person is doing what they're doing. But you're still running into problems. You still run into a little bit of conflict. You're still running into issues, and you're still trying to figure out what's going on. Why am I still having challenges with this person? Maybe I need to teach this person MBTI. So this is where a lot of people, they'll study it, quick hobby, and then they'll fall away. This is not what we need to be doing in the sense of people who are MBTI enthusiasts. In fact, what I've seen lately, and I'll say this in the last 3 months, is people who are MBTI hobbyists or Jungian psychology or functions or socionics, they tend to be more discriminatory, right? Because at the end of the day, we're all people, but then when you start adding these labels like, hey, you're not an NT, so get lost. I mean, if you didn't know MBTI, you wouldn't do that, right? You just go, okay, maybe that guy's an idiot. That's maybe what you would do as an NT. That's kind of natural for NTs. But I mean, at the end of the day, you wouldn't judge somebody because they're not a certain thing. You would just try to evaluate. So we got to go back to the roots and understand, yes, why we got an MBTI, and then understand what can we do about it? How can we use what we've learned from MBTI and actually integrate it into something that we can actually apply in our daily lives, something that we can actually use to be able to improve our relationships with other people? Because at the end of the day, that's what it's about. That's why most MBTI enthusiasts are actually NFs. Yeah, Daniel.
Yeah. I made a video that has yet to be uploaded, I believe. I do like a rant on MBTI and like just like the different different applications of all these different systems. Like it's really supposed to enhance your lifestyle, your own personal awareness, and like it's really secondary to kind of connect these systems with like other people, in my opinion. Because if you don't have it down pat for yourself, if you can't really understand the system, you know, how are you going to be able to apply it efficiently and have it make sense with other people? Whereas, you know, we're bridging the gap in this video between NLP and MBTI. You know, there's so many people out there that identify MBTI and they kind of they kind of just take these like singularities of like functions and they say like, you know, oh, I was acting all TI today and, you know, random thoughts like that. And, you know, so you have like this really messy kind of slow moving growth. You know, I wonder if there's any kind of better methods to grow when you first are introduced to MBTI. Maybe we can do more videos on how to have like people who are first introduced to these typing systems and then have them assimilate to a place, you know, assimilate way easier than it be a mudslide of chaos.
Yeah, and that's what it is right now. You have an argument amongst the fellow people who are studying MBTI in the sense of theories. It's like one person will say FE is this way, another person will say FE is this way, and you get this clash. It actually creates more conflict because now it's an intellectual conflict about something that most people may think that they have, but also can bring people together. I'm not trying to ignore the positive benefits, but I'm just saying that we can always improve in the way that we're using this knowledge to be able to improve our relationships actively. So it's not about cognitive functions. It's not really going to help you in the sense of improving your relationship. Sure, you can have a good understanding, but conflict resolution is coming from a place of understanding your natural preferences and understanding more of this is the way that I tend to be and how do I control this. Now, by nature, I can say I've done this in myself over the years through a lot of practice. And what I mean this, and I'll say this, is when I was 18, 17, 16, I was an extremely forceful person to the point where I pretty much just drove everyone away because I applied so much pressure to everyone. I wanted everyone to do my dirty work. I wanted everyone to do everything. And I applied pressure in a very vicious, hostile way. And I recognized that this was causing a lot of conflict and actually eliminating the things that I wanted in life, which were good relationships and having people in my life. So I started reading books and trying to understand, okay, why am I doing this? What's going on? I didn't know NLP at the time, so it was a long, tedious journey. And now I'm a little more slower to react to where I feel like I could jump in. I still feel the impulse because that's natural. I don't know if that'll ever change, but it's under control in the sense that I don't naturally have to do that anymore. So for me, the journey was a lot longer, but with NLP, you can recognize the triggers for this psychological pattern and start actually working on it directly and saying, okay, if I lead with this preference, which say it's a TE Dom, let's just go with thinking, right? You're thinking Dom, you're naturally going to push away emotional, human, or idiosyncratic factors that don't have a cause-effect protocol or don't have a pros-cons protocol or don't have a correct-incorrect protocol, a polarity that actually can be validated through evidence, right? You have the human element, which is much more complex, and really, you can spend time trying to understand quantum physics and everything else in a logical, systematic manner. But when it really boils down to it, the human whole humanity in itself is infinitely more complex than any non-human topic you can study. And I know a lot of people probably disagree with me, but I honestly truly feel that people understanding people is a lifelong journey, and it's never been mastered to the point where you can keep studying people and still make a lot of mistakes. Whereas you can master math, you can be a genius mathematician, you can master these other systematic principles. So that for the dominant thinkers who feel that the human element or the human information is irrelevant, it doesn't have to be that way. You got to look at it and go, okay, why do I feel this way about the human element? What is it that makes me want to do this? Why do I push these people away? What part of me goes, I don't need people? What part of me goes, I need to ignore these elements? As I've grown over the years and I've witnessed this, I've started considering a lot more values in my life than I did previously. And overall, it's made me more effective person than I would have if I ignored these values. I have people on my channel obviously say things like, you know, hey, you're tapping in your FI or whatever, but I am. And I truly believe it's a place of growth. And I don't really agree that, you know, because we're a certain type, we need to settle and accept that we're going to be dicks to people. So, you know, I'm not about settling. I'm about improving, about becoming a better version of myself every day. And, you know, as Trey and Blake said in their visit here, that they're, you know, become the legendary version of yourself. So, and this is, you know, where Daniel says, be the architect of your own story.
Oh, I love that. I love that saying.
Yeah. And so you have these concepts that we're all discussing and we're all trying to understand the aspect that we are crafting our own story every day. And it's not about what you attain in materialism. It's not about how much things you can accumulate through your life. It's about how well you can treat other people. And I said this in my loneliness video, there's two very important things that you take to your grave. It's yourself and being authentic and true to yourself. And it doesn't matter if you're an Effie or a Fry Dom, or it's about, you know, how your relationships with other people. What impact did you have on them? How was that relationship? What difference did you make? You know, it doesn't have to be 100 people. It doesn't have to be 5,000 people. It can be one person, yourself. What relationship do you have with yourself? All right, so with that being set aside, I do want to dive into a little bit of the NLP side of this. So we understand MBTI, we understand the cognitive preferences, and understand that NLP, we can work directly with these components, right? We can work with the components that say, I have this aspect, I can work with this component. Okay, so let's look at these natural preferences of MBTI and say, what's a typical problem for somebody who leads with thinking? Well, they tend to make decisions, especially TE. If we look at TE, it's a quick decision-making process. Sometimes not always making the right decision, but what seems most applicable and useful and resourceful here and now, right? What can we do in this exact situation? And every situation is going to be different. The pragmatism that comes with TE. So if we look at this and go, they're not considering all perspectives, right? They may make a decision too quickly. All right, so what this is in NLP, we can use a simple technique. We can just rebuild a strategy. The strategy of approaching a problem-solving method. How do I normally solve problems? Well, this is what happens. Step A, step B, step C, step D. Okay, I made it a 14-step process. Is that really necessary? Am I concluding all these other aspects? Okay, I'm going to brainstorm a new strategy, and it's going to be a 3-step process. Once I have that new strategy I brainstormed, I wrote it down on paper, I will input that into my mind. And then all of a sudden, when you're approached with a situation where somebody asked you a question, you're going to be, now let's say that you added this take in all perspectives part of your strategy, you may ask the person before making a decision, what do you think? Do you know how much value you can give to a person by, let's say a person respects you and they respect the crap out of you. And, you know, you never ask them what they thought. And then one random day, you're like, you know, I'm very curious to what you think about this. I think most people would be pretty honored by somebody they respect asking for their opinion, and especially if the opinion they like it, they appreciate it. So it's a relationship builder. And you realize, okay, as a thinker, yes, I still do what I do, but now I can actually take in multiple perspectives. As TE Dom, I can learn to make a decision and sit back for a second and take in the perspectives of other people that I care about. And there's a reason why I have them around me. I appreciate the perspective. I don't necessarily have to make a decision off what they say, which is part of strategy. Maybe it's the third step to evaluate all perspectives, then make the decision, right? So I've cut down this 14-step decision-making process now to a 4-step decision-making process. So it's working with these decision-making strategies that would help a lot of the functions, not just TE, but that was an example of how it works. I'm gonna take a break and let you guys talk for a second. Daniel?
I was going to ask you, because, you know, you were focusing on TE for this example. Do you think that all the other functions that are extroverted preference kind of act in the same way?
The judging acts in one way and the perceiving acts in another way.
Gotcha.
Yeah, you know, I mean, if you're looking at SE or any, for example, let's say that you're picking up a perception that, okay, let's say that you've had a traumatic life as an NE dumb, and you might be semi-paranoid. You might think that people are out to get you or hurt you or make things worse. This is a meta program you have in place. Okay, so what you do is you would remove that meta program and install a new meta program.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and all of a sudden, now that you're not seeing that anymore, life can be a lot more pure and clean to you. And you're not programming yourself to be naive. We always check ecology. You know, if you remove this filter, what is exposed and what kind of new program do we need to install? Right. So this really is what boils down to it. And there's a lot of stuff out there that says, you know, that it can be dangerous changing your meta programs. And it can. I mean, if you change your meta program, you don't check ecology.
I mean, in that sense, you're kind of changing how the whole car works. You know what I mean?
You're changing your own life perspective. You're seeing things in a different way. It's like you stared at the cup half empty your whole life, and then all of a sudden you can now see it half full, and it's hard to go back. You're like, what happened? It's like a revelation, but it was induced by your own programming, right? And so this can tie to any cognitive function as far as that goes. And you would just pick a different NLP technique based on what it is that you're dealing with and the situation you're dealing with. There's not a one size fits all. It's you have to use the right technique dependent on what you're dealing with at any given time or any current situation that you're dealing with. It could be situational or it could be a recurring pattern, whether it's you get stage fright or whether you have a fear of spiders so bad that you freeze, or whether it's, you know, talking to somebody or approaching girls if you're looking for dates, or whatever it may be, that you can deal with it and you can deal with it effectively. And you may be a very powerful person, but you may have a fear of something so simple, right? You can be a very powerful person in general, but it's ridiculous what you can be afraid of. Like for me, when I was younger, I was a pretty strong-willed, strong-minded person, but you put a spider in front of me and my life was over. I mean, I was terrified of spiders, and now I'm not. I just hate them still. Maybe I should change that. But I can't stand them to this day. But the point is, you know,
I used to collect spiders.
Yeah, you're a sick bastard. but yeah, ultimately, Trey, I can't hear you. You got no audio, Trey.
No audio, mate.
So, Trey will fix that in a second. I'm curious to hear his thoughts. I don't know if I want to pause for him. I'll wait for him, because if I start talking, he'll lose it.
I think he's just telling us to keep going.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
So anyway, yeah. So ultimately, the fear of dealing with something, whatever it may be that you have, is it can be a problem that you're dealing with. So when you're using NLP with MBTI, it's ultimately about your situations and relationships with people, whether you're trying to make a romantic or intimate relationship work, or whether you're dealing with friends, or your friends see you as some asshole, and they appreciate that part of that quality, but there's parts they don't appreciate. Right, I have friends who tell me, if I want the hard, cold truth, I'll go to you. And then they say at the same time, they're like, but if I ever wanted somebody to really take care of me or to feel safe with, it wouldn't be you, because I feel like you'd hurt me.
Right.
So I've had people tell me this kind of thing. And so there's positive and negative qualities in which things that you present to people. And, you know, and so you can say, okay, in my case, these are true scenarios for me. I could go, well, maybe I can retain one aspect of this and actually discard the other aspect, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I can hear you, Trey.
You can hear me?
Yeah.
Oh, dope. All right. I was just going to say that I have a confession to make. Earlier, I saw a spider, and I totally forgot that you had a fear of them or didn't like, sorry, not fear of them, but didn't like
Trey,
them.
Are you not using your headphone mic? Because it's really
That's annoying, man.
Use your headphone mic.
Oh, there we go. That should work.
There you go.
Better? Yeah. All right, yeah, so point is, I saw a spider earlier and I didn't kill it, so sorry.
Oh.
I mean, it was graceful, though. It was on the wall and jumped off, and it looked pretty cool.
Right.
Yeah. Anyways, NLP, what were we saying?
You know, I think these meta programs can be very useful because, you know, I think there comes to a point when people realize that, you know, as you're narrowing down on the variables that you're missing to match into either who you want to be or what you want in your life, you know, it's almost like reconfiguring the meta programs could be like the last kind of like brooms, like swoosh, right, to making everything work, you know. Whereas, like, if people don't really do that investigative work, you're really kind of just throwing, you know, crap against the wall, and you're really trying to see, like, all right, well, you know, this is what I think the problem might be. But, you know, I think it would really help if people do that kind of inner work and then really work with somebody before, right? Wouldn't you agree with that? You would really make sure that changing the meta program is the right course of action.
Yes. Yeah, you definitely want to check the ecology. That's what we call an NLP, check the ecology. Make sure that the thing you're installing has no negative consequences.
Right.
Yeah, because you got to remember, NLP has a very core concept that everything you do, every behavior, whether good or bad, always has a positive core intention. And so it's serving you in some way. Right? So let me give you an example. When I was president of a migraine clinic a couple years ago, or a year ago, or whatever, time flies these days, you know, when I was president of this clinic, I would bring in patients, and these patients obviously wanted their migraines fixed. And they consciously go in, they're paying money to get their migraine fixed. But at some core level, they actually didn't want it fixed. And it sounds kind of crazy. It's not like they told me they didn't want it necessarily, but they were getting benefit from having this symptom or having this migraine or having these symptoms. And they subconsciously resisted getting fixed. Anytime we would get them almost to the past that tipping point where they'd be permanently fixed, they'd sabotage themselves. Self-sabotage. And this is where NLP comes in and actually can fix this issue. And is when you recognize that these people are self-sabotaging, because consciously, yeah, they all want to get fixed. They all go in and go, I want to get rid of the pain. But think about what that migraine is giving them. They get care. Maybe their husband or spouse or whoever is actually being so careful with this person now and giving them care, they actually feel loved. And so if their migraines are fixed, their spouse will stop showing them that love. And that's actually worse than the physical pain. Maybe they are getting financial benefits from being disabled. Maybe you got to see that there's all kinds of benefits that are associated with these things. And it's your mind is going to be attached with whatever behavior you think is positive or negative, right? It has some kind of core positive intention. It's serving some type of need. And if you can understand that, and you're getting to the right step of being able to address that need in another way. So if we're using NLP in this way, and we go, okay, you need the husband to care for you, and he's not demonstrating that he cares, right? You need the spouse or whatever. I say husband because most of the patients are female. So you see the spouse, and you need that kind of attention. You need that kind of care, right? So you can start addressing this. How can we provide that to you without being migrant? You can start destroying different ways that can be satisfied. So once you replace that with something else, you can actually fix the issue of the migraine and you're no longer dependent on it. The concept of NLP and its use is identifying that every action that you're doing, whether it's positive or negative, has that core positive intention. And it's under that premise. It's identifying that as a core part of the NLP process, is learning not to judge your particular aspects of your character as a negative or positive, and learning to remove polarity, where Enneagram also comes into play, because Enneagram is a lot about removing this kind of polar thinking to non-polar thinking, understanding that it is, period, right? It is. And that's what it is. So that stupid cliche saying, it is what it is, that's kind of the angle of attack that Enneagram is trying to teach us. And if we can understand that Enneagram is representing a lot of the fixations that we have, combining NLP as an active tool and Enneagram as a passive tool in understanding, and MBTI as a passive tool in understanding, you can actually reach a lot of self-development rather quickly.
Oh yeah, and Enneagram is, even if you look at Enneagram through the lens of NLP, you really see all the meta programs that each type has and uses quite a bit, quite well. Just each type and the different ways that they're handling different parts of their life. You can almost look at a problem that they're having, and you can almost like completely understand where they're coming from when it comes to why they're so upset or why they're deeply affected by whatever's going on. Seems like to me.
Yeah, Daniel, you have anything to add? You're on mute.
It really seems that, you know, when I think about Dario Nardi's work and I think about how MBTI really focuses on functionality, you know, which is kind of NLP's forte, really, right? Really looking at these systems, like these little miniature systems. It's interesting how it kind of all connects, but it's not really connected. It's not the same system. So how do you think these all kind of, I mean, I don't know if you know the history of all, like, you know, NLP and MBTI, but it's just really strange how they kind of correlate pretty, you know, interestingly. Like, if you wanted to compare them, like one complements the other in some ways.
Yeah, and the history of NLP is not a long one, but it's there from 1970 forward. MBTI goes back to the much younger than that. Older than that, I'm sorry. MBTI is a lot older than that, so. But having an understanding, there's no problem with knowledge, but knowledge is limited in a lot of ways. People say knowledge is power. I think it's more about, you know, it's the application of knowledge is more powerful than just knowledge. I guess that comes from the point of wisdom. Understanding, you know, that some things you can know but aren't really going to serve a certain purpose in your life. And I'm sure that you guys may be asking questions today about what NLP techniques to use and that type of thing. That gets into a whole other topic. So I really can't cover all that today. But And everybody's different. There's not a magic solution. I can't say everybody use swish technique. Everybody use map across. Everybody use perceptual positions, or everybody use this or whatever. I can't really go into these long monologues and tell you what technique to use. It's a little bit of trial and error figuring out, okay, depends on what modality you're using, right? Are you using the auditory modality? Are you using the visual? What's your primary representational system? And which one is the way that you're mapping? Because if we think about the mental map, we think about, you know, the map behind Daniel, for example. This is a visual representation of the actual Earth, right? It's visual, right? Maybe there's, for you, maybe it's an audio, right? Maybe it'll say across the distance you have this. And then if we were to think about a world map, but in an audio form, how would that look? For people who are auditory or primary representational system of reality through an auditory means, that's very possible. Whereas people who are not as auditory may find it really, really difficult. I gotta see it. Well, no, not necessarily, right? You know, I'm sure there's blind people out there who know how the world looks. You know, maybe, and you know, in their own way, their own map of reality. It's not exact, it won't be an exact replication, but neither is that map behind Daniel. But they have an idea, right? Because something has been explained to them in a auditory way. You know, or you know, somebody who has a kinesthetic way of understanding things. And I find this really interesting with the kinesthetic representational system, is sometimes people can feel their way in reality. And people who have the kinesthetic representational system also understand that, you know, sometimes the physical reality of what we experience here is not necessarily real reality. What I feel is actually more real to me than physical, tangible reality to someone who's kinesthetic, right? And they think that the map behind Daniel is very limited. Each particular thing has its own energy, its own essence. And how does that look if you were to remove substance or to remove matter? How would those things look to you? How would the world change in its appearance if you were to remove matter and realize everything as its essence or structure? And that's the magic behind understanding that people are looking at the world through a primary representational system. And yeah, you'll use other representational systems too, but you have a primary one. So this comes into understand that we do not understand each other in full if we don't understand people's representational systems. And I mean, I've been in conflicts, many conflicts with friends and people I've known or not known that well. And I had one particular person mention to me that said, you know, what's more real to me is the way that I feel than the actual facts of the situation. The way that I feel is truth to me. And of course, I, at the time, was not very pleasant. I was pretty irritated, so I discarded that as trash or garbage or rubbish, right? I was like, well, that's bull crap. I was like, you can prove this, but you can't prove the way you're feeling doesn't prove anything, because that's not the facts of the situation. So that probably wasn't the smartest thing to say or do in that particular relationship scenario at the given time. But because I didn't understand the person's perspective or the way that the person is representing reality, that's just as real as anything that I could have said to them. You know, I've talked with a lot of people who have pain, past pain, trauma, all kinds of things, and they say things like, you know, my mom hates me or whatever, or somebody hates me. And we know they really don't hate them, but, you know, and they know that. At the end of the day, they tell me, I know they really don't, but I feel like they do. And real or imagined, the feeling is real. The feeling is real. It doesn't matter what the actual influencer, the stimulus is that's creating that. The feeling is there. And that is just as real as any physical matter or physical reality. And until we can start understanding that makes it's going to be difficult to be able to fully understand our relationships with other people, and understanding that we have a totally alternative approach to looking through a different lens. Like these are, one person may be looking at the world through a red-colored lens, and the other looking at the world through a rose-colored lens, another person looking at the world through this pink lens and blue lens, and then all of a sudden everything starts changing, right? You have a different viewpoint of the world. And when you see things that differently, you're looking at somebody who lived in an entirely different culture. And I experienced this as culture shock when I have people who are not from the United States come visit, some friends of mine or whatever in the past who are from Japan or from South America or even Europe, you know, Africa. Even Africa is really interesting. And you have somebody coming from Africa and their culture is so different, right? And it's like they've lived in an entirely different planet. It's like you become so centered on what you think is reality, and then you realize that there's something so different in a different part of the world. But we can parallel this into the way that we're actually seeing reality, right? I first experienced this when I was dealing with a ESTP in MBTI, and I realized that he saw the world entirely different than I did. And I was like, the way that I saw it was totally different. And I was like, whoa, this is strange. Like, I actually kind of was able to put myself in his shoes for 1 minute and realize that how he saw the world, why he acted the way he did. And it really made a lot of sense that I stopped judging him for being so impulsive and sporadic. You know, and I was like, he's just all over this guy. He just really doesn't think. But after a while, I was starting to see that there was a reason for that kind of behavior and how he was producing that. And I was like, oh, now that makes sense. Right. That's what's going on. So, Daniel, you want to add anything?
Yeah, like it's interesting how, and like I've always really loved seeing this, like the diversity of personal experience, and that the center of, you know, the center of the universe is not you, even though it's your reality, you know, you are coexisting. And so it's kind of like, you know, I picture like life or the world as one big kind of like graph paper, but like in the shape as a shape of the globe. And I'm just exploring all these different plot points that are people, you know, within this world, you know? And so there's all these just different kind of intersecting points of different realities that I want to get to understand, because, you know, at the end of the day, you know, how we expand is through new perceptions. And so I like to see it as like, you know, graph points, and like, I'm always just trying to find the next graph point to kind of create a more developed understanding of my own significance within it all, and to really appreciate all the other plot points, and you know what other people have to offer, you know, and their story and what they go through. And it's just really interesting how people navigate their lives and how they've been, I guess, programmed, or how they're fighting their own programming, or how they broke out of their own programming, and now like they're just so super like motivated and empowered, and like they're in a really great place, you know. It's all really cool.
Trey?
I actually got caught up in the chat. Could you just give me a brief topic? Brief thing that you were talking about?
Yeah, what you just said. Daniel.
What's up?
Sorry. Can you recap what you just said?
Oh, I was talking about how, you know, how I see like everybody in the whole world as like plot points, like on a graph, and like just everybody has like their own personal experience and conditioning and programming that they're either fighting or thriving from. And it's just cool because like we naturally want to believe that, you know, our reality is kind of like the permanent or the most, I guess, you know, important or influential, when really we're just collecting on like the road that we're walking on through life. We're just journeying through these different plot points and just kind of adding on and building, you know, based on our decision making, right?
Yeah, you know, that makes me think of this girl I was talking to recently. She works with me at my job, and I remember, you know, we had a long discussion actually about dating a long time ago, and how, like, you know, men should approach women and how women how women should respond, you know, just out of basic courtesy and character. And I just remember, like, because you were talking about how everyone's a little bit pretty localized, you know what I mean, kind of feeling like their own perception of things in their own life is a bit more significant because that's what they're living. You know what I mean? And so everyone has pretty localized opinions and beliefs and stuff like that. But with this girl, I remember we were talking, and I gave her, like, we had talked about, you know, how, you know, women should give men a chance was one of the topics in the entire conversation. And it was just one of many, so I didn't really give it any special attention or anything. But then later she told me that she had given some guy a chance and it didn't work out so well. And I was telling her that, you know, it's probably because she had an expectation as to how it was supposed to turn out. Like, you know, when I was talking about it originally, it was more about courtesy and character. But she had set up a expectation on the relationship or whatever it was. And I said, you know, I asked her a little bit more information about what was going on. She talked about how they were both getting a bit defensive over some stuff. And I talked about how really they were just both fighting each other because they were trying to feel good in a way. You know, we have different things that we're all struggling with. And I think that when it came to her situation and it comes to a lot of our situations, we just don't like all the pressure that we have to feel. And so we try to fight back, and all we do is push pressure back on other people. And I said, really, the response that you should give this person is one out of recognition, I guess, that they're also feeling something. You know, they're going through some stuff. And I think it's important. One of the main things I've been focusing on, one of the main ideas I've been thinking about recently, is how damaging it is to set expectations on relationships and stuff like that. Because, I mean, you know, if I set an expectation on a relationship with some girl, for example, I may, like, get pretty attached to her in the concept of, like, us having a relationship. And then when she doesn't want to have one, it's like, you know, I get super upset. When I could have just enjoyed her for her personality and all the things her talents and things she contributes to my life or takes away. I mean, thing is, we only have one chance. So why should we decide to enjoy certain things in life over other things? It's just, it's selfish. And I think that a lot of times we have our own localized, it's like a big bubble of opinions. It's almost talking to us and telling us, like, oh, hey, no, sorry. It's like a big bubble of opinions. And it's like, it's talking to us saying, oh, yeah, no, here's what you should think. Like, or I don't know, like, here's what you should be worried about. That person could be doing this. This could be happening, you know. Oh, like, did you see how they treated you? Just like, I don't know, just all this stuff. And like, some part of it wants something, you know. It's like all of these different things that we're setting, placing on ideas and people and things in life. And it creates a lot of stress later on. And I think that you made a really good point, Daniel, when you said that, you know, people are localized. People are on like this. They're just one point on the graph, and they're just moving around. Like
billions of little points, and it's not about.
It's like they have to. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, like it's never about expectation. When you meet someone new, it's like imagine like you're the king of one country, and you're going over to another country to meet the other king, and so like culture is fused, cultural diffusion. Right, almost, and you're just kind of accepting and appreciating how one another, you know, lives their own lifestyle, right? And so, like, when you meet somebody or you're romantically connecting with somebody, you know, it's not about the expectation, because the expectation is really about, you know, fear. It's about, you know, it's about a lot of other things, but connecting, you know, expectation, you can say to some extent, is really separation, right? Because you're expecting some kind of comfortability from the relationship. So, like, you know, you never want to have an expectation. You only want to appreciate that person within the present moment. Appreciate with presence.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, why ever set any kind of bar for anything instead of just enjoying it? And Little Miss Harbor had a question about she wanted me to give an example of the expectation. And I can do that. When there was this one girl I met, and she kind of changed a lot of my life perspective when I met her. And she brought a whole other spectrum in that I didn't even think existed before. And it made me appreciate people as a whole altogether, because at one point I believed that people were people weren't real. And when I say that, I just mean that it was frustrating, because I knew that they were, but at the same time, I'd talk to them and I'd want to get to know them, and just seemed like things were getting more and more automated responses. You know, people would respond in a certain way. Just, oh, no. Like, it seems like no matter who I talk to, they all give the same response or one of these same responses, instead of like actually engaging, like, you know, in relationship. And what she had shown me this whole spectrum of life I'd never seen was that people are just hurting and they're putting up these walls. And when a wall becomes popular, it's like, oh, hey, that's a really great way to hide that thing that I'm worried about. I'm going to use that too. And so then everyone's got these walls and it makes them all look fake. And so when I met her, she completely changed my life perspective. She probably meant the most to me versus anyone else I'd ever met, especially when it comes to women. And yet, I set an expectation on her and what I wanted from her. You know what I mean? Like, I wanted a certain relationship. I wanted a certain future. You know what I mean? And all that did was mess things up. And that doesn't have to be in relationships, really. It can be in anything. The fact that I wanted to have like a certain relationship with her instead of just enjoying her for exactly what she brought into my life, which is a whole new, fresh perspective. She showed me humanity. You know what I mean? Like, just all these things that I just seemed to like it let me down. Like, how did all of this let me down with all that I've learned and all that I've seen? And the kind of relationship that was already there, why do I feel left down, like let down, like it should have been better? So that's the expectation, I guess. It's an example of it. It doesn't always have to appear in the form of a relationship. It can show up as really anything, just like your life. You can set expectations on your life, like, oh, things should go this way, and you're disappointed, instead of naturally just enjoying things exactly how they are. Even, you know, I have a really weird worldview, so I'm just going to share this really quick. When I am set in a position of, like, where things could go wrong, like, you know, when it comes to anything, really, I think, this could happen. This is a possibility. Will this happen? And when it does go wrong, I'm not necessarily upset. Like, I wish it could have gone better, maybe, but I enjoy, like, the fact that I knew, which is weird. Like, I'll be like, oh, yeah, I had a suspicion this person would do this to me. Darn. But the fact that I knew, I could prepare for it. And I don't even think that preparation is the answer. I just think that when it comes to us as people, I think a lot of times we get so upset when something happens a certain way, but why get upset about it when we can just enjoy exactly what it was and how it was? Because once it's gone, it's gone. And, you know, Damon's even had an example of someone that he cared quite a lot about. And I hear about this person, how amazing they are. I'm like, dude, you know what I mean? This person's awesome. So I can understand why, you know, later he would feel so upset when that person was gone from his life. And I think we all do that. But instead of, like, necessarily just taking that person and be like, wow, like, the fact that they existed in my life. And I think that a lot of us, almost all of us, lose that perspective of enjoying it, what it was while it's there.
Yeah, I think it's really about letting things be and appreciating things for what they are without ownership.
Yeah, so just for the audience, I'm going to take off real quick. I hope you guys got some value from this. I'm going to keep the show going, of course. I just have to exit. I've got a client, but I appreciate you guys. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you on the next live show. Daniel, Trey, good work.
Great All job, right. guys. Sure.
Take care.
See ya. Trey, you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah, like I think that's a really interesting philosophy because I have something similar that I go by. You know, it's really just about gratitude and appreciation. Like, you know, if something happens to you, negative or positive, it's still like an experience. And if you live beyond the duality of what that means to you, it's just another situation that you have existed with and now it has passed, right? And, you know, I've always kind of reacted like that to situation, whether I was in like a car accident or, you know, I had ended a relationship or something like that. It's just, it is what it is. You know, you learn from it. Hopefully you appreciated the experiences that even in negative experiences, like, you know, learning and being with negativity, that way you can either retain more awareness or knowledge or kind of like a better route for decision-making, right? You know, it's kind of like, we're pinballing against all these different decisions that we make and it creates experiences. And then we ask ourselves, like, why did we have this experience? Like, you know, like, man, I really wish I was. And then we ask ourselves, I wish I was in control of my life. Meanwhile, you're the ones making the decisions to have these experiences to begin with. So it's like, at what point do we stop unconsciously, you know, navigating ourselves, right? And we start directing, right? Start becoming the architect and the creator of our own life, right? And it's a lot of responsibility, and a lot of people don't really feel like they want to do it, you know? And, you know, actually, I did a workshop once for a healthcare business, and one of the exercises was you know, that box theory I always talk about, Trey? I had all these employees do box theory, which is pretty much, it's a piece of paper, and you write everything that's in your life on this piece of paper, and then you write a positive or negative next to it. And so, in, you know, on one piece of paper, you can pretty much see everything in your life that's either going right or wrong in your life. And people will just stare at this paper, right? And they will just be like, huh, it was that easy, right? You know what I mean? But like, a lot of people don't want to start changing around their life. They don't want to be the one responsible going like, whoosh, all right, you're out, or you're in, you know what I mean? It kind of gets way more existential once you start really seeing things in that kind of perspective, right? And a lot of people aren't kind of ready for that. But I think, you know, it's just one of those things that, like, when you navigate your life, make sure, and it ties in with NLP, you know, you absorb so much data, right? And you make so many decisions, you know, at what point are you going to say to yourself, like, you know what, it's just all a mindset, you know? My mindset guides my decisions, and my decisions create the experiences that I go through. And, you know, I see this all the time with people. You know, you see this with relationships that always kind of people, you see this with like the people that break up and then they get back together. You see this with just so many different situations in life, people who have anger issues, you know, people who have depression. You know, it's about reliving the same mindsets, and then the same decisions follow and the same actions follow. And then, you know, you just go through the same cycles, whereas there are ways out of those ways of thinking. And it's kind of funny because when people start off the new year, everybody starts like as if they wanted to break the cycle, but then realize how great it is to feel comfortable with how they're existing, right? Like, you know what? I'm just going to let the universe take care of me. I'm not going to really take the control room and just kind of move everything around, right? People would rather let the universe do that for you, but that's really just kind of like taking your hand off the wheel and hope you kind of land on a road that's like 80 feet wide, right? You really hope that, you know, you're not on a really stretched thin road, and, you know, and you're driving, you let go of the wheel. You wish you were on a mile wide road.
Universe, for the case. Universe, take the turn. What are you doing? Turn left. What the hell? It's almost like you're waiting for the universe to be like, all right, man, $1 million.
it's truly, yeah, like it's truly interesting. Like, you know, how much people like refuse like to take that responsibility, even though they say that they're responsible of their life, to say, you know, I'm responsible in my life. Like, okay, take the wheel that is your life so universe doesn't drive, right? Nope. They can do it, right? It's like people almost don't trust themselves to make their own decisions, whereas like that's what they think they're really doing, right? Which is like the ironic part, is like they think that, all right, I have my mindset, it may not be the best, but I'm okay with what the decisions that will follow and then the experiences as a result, right? But you have to remember, it all starts with your mindset. It all starts with reprogramming yourself.
I actually have a comment to make, another story that just came to mind. There's this friend of mine that the other day, she's actually talking to me, and she was messaging me, and out of nowhere, she sends me another message and says, I just found out that my boyfriend was cheating on me. Like, just out of nowhere. While we were talking, I was like, oh, wow. Huh. I said, so how are you doing? And she was like, I'm fine. She's like, I knew it was going to happen. And I was like, okay, so why are you upset? And she was like, well, because I feel like I should have done something about it. You know what I mean? I should have done something to change it. And I said, well, I mean, this is what I'm showing you is just that this girl right here still she has a whole different way of handling it, and yet she was content with exactly what was going on.
Well, you know what?
She said she cared for the person. She says she enjoyed having him in her life. But, you know, if he's going to do that, like, it's not something she can choose. You know what I mean? It's not in her control.
Yeah, it's not in her control.
And I remember... go ahead.
But at the same time, though, in a way, she's letting the universe kind of steer her car, right? You know, she didn't get upset, like really upset. She probably came off as more melancholy, right?
Yeah, she was, yeah. That's a probably good description.
Because if she came off as melancholy, then that would explain the whole, you know, why she didn't get upset. Because it's kind of like, imagine you're a kid and your mom is like going shopping and you're like, you see cookies and your mom, you know, is tall enough to grab the cookie for you. And this would signify the boyfriend cheating, right? And so you go as the kid, hey, mom, grab that cookie. And the mom goes, no. And you're like, oh, right? And that's like acting as if the kid cannot themselves get the cookie, but they can, right? And so I love it when people, and I enjoy these situations where people diffuse themselves, like they will go so far as to diffuse themselves instead of taking responsibility of their course of action and decisions. Like if this girl you're talking about took ownership of her life, she would have been all over this. She would have been really like either upset or like getting into the situation, trying to save it. But because she thinks that she's not in control of her life, she let the universe take the wheel and said, hey, like, you know, you can't have this. And she pretty much just took it. And so when this happens to people, what ends up happening is it starts to manifest bigger and bigger snowballs, right? It just keeps revolving bigger and bigger. And so I wouldn't be surprised if something else happened to her after that, that got even more upset until she realized.
I was actually thinking when she did that, that the mistake she made was that she actually expected that, and this is a mistake I make, is that she actually expected it to happen. She had placed an expectation on the relationship because I think that,
destined it for failure almost.
Yeah. I mean, what is time is like a really interesting concept, just the way it works and everything. So you don't know where it's going to go. So, I mean, it's, I have this concept I'm trying to get out of me that's really hard to explain right now, but I'm actually going to revert because there was something else. The thing is, she, just people in general, I think, have to understand there's a much bigger playing field, just like you were saying with the plots. And I think that a really good explanation of this, I was actually working the other day and I was doing my work and stuff. And this dude was next to me and I just started laughing, man. And he was like, what? And I looked over and I was like, I just had a scenario playing in my head where one person was coming up to me and they're like, oh dude, man, I got fired from my job. And I said, that's good. Like, what? Why? What? That? What do you mean? That's so messed up. Like, I need money. Like, I have kids. And I'm like, yeah. But it's still good. They're like, what? Why? And I'm like, well, because some dude's about to get a job. And I was like, you got fired, so some dude's gonna replace you. They're like, what? But me? They're like, but me? Like, look at me. I have these issues and needs. And I was like, yeah. So all you're doing is waiting for someone else to get fired. You know what I mean? And it was a point to make where it puts you in perspective. We're so localized. We're on our own point instead of looking at the whole graph, and we're so frustrated with our own shit. But like, we have to, you know, we live, there's a much bigger picture, and when I get fired from my job, someone else is going to take my place. Not always, but there's another reason for that. There's money fluctuation. You know what I mean? One company may not be doing so good, that's probably because another company's doing great. You know what I mean? And it's just like there's this whole scheme that we're not seeing because we're so localized and we're so stuck to ourselves that when it comes to situations where, you know,
hey,
we want to complain. And I would like to wrap back into your point that you were saying earlier about still creating your reality. And I think that when it comes to you creating your reality, you shouldn't be shooting for certain things. Like, I think that sometimes we have a problem. We say, this would be the solution to my problem. This right here would be what would fix everything. And when we do that, I think we cause more problems than we solve. I think it's more about, I think it's more about like just being yourself and finding what it is that you truly just connect, what you bring. Like for me, for example, one of the biggest things I think I can contribute is my own thoughts. Like I wish that I had a much more influential channel. You know what I mean? I wish that I had much more people to listen, because I may not be like super intelligent or anything, and I may not know a lot, but like I know that a lot of the stuff that I've learned and that I've been able to absorb, the things that I've been able to put together, have helped so many people that I wish I had more influence. You know what I mean? And that's just something that when I think about what my job would be, naturally it's just to think and to explain and to express. Because truthfully, like when someone teaches something to me, I get frustrated because I'm like, that person could have taught me this way. Now, I did set an expectation on them, but that's besides the point. You know, well, I'm frustrated because, sorry, go ahead.
No, but that's like a very interesting segue, because you're thinking about how the navigation of life, and really you wish you had those opportunities. And Natalie here is talking about how she wishes that she can get into one of these schools. Whereas you literally just said it's not about the actual experiences, but you kind of foreshadowed the idea. And I totally agree with this concept as well, that life isn't about achieving particularities. It's about creating the probability of more opportunities for yourself, right? The probability of creating more opportunities. So by creating more opportunities, there's a higher probability that you are going to be able to select something that's in favor of what you want, right? And so, you know, how I see this is that, you know, like I'm going to give you an example. Like I just started a vlog, right? I'm on my actual Daniel Spies channel. And like every day I'm just making like a 5-minute vlog about just my life, my struggles and my issues and whatever. And, you know, I have like a little, I sum up at the end, like something like philosophical to maybe help somebody. And I'm like, huh, I wonder if this will get big someday. But like, that's not the point. The point is about the one viewer it gets per video that I may impact, right?
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's not about who you will impact, but it's about being present and impacting people now and letting that be so influential that people spread your content because of how impactful that it is, right? Like people think that there's, you know, like time will eventually help you when you are consistently impacting the world. Time will always give that to you. Time is always a bitch in a lot of senses, but what it does give back to you is when you're always putting karma out, it funnels that right back to you tenfold. And this channel is a very great depiction of that. You know, we have come very far on this channel and we've impacted a lot of people. We've created a community. Hey guys in the chat, you know, and we are making our impact slowly but surely. It's not as speedy as other channels, right? But at the same time, we are creating multiple opportunities, and within that, it's a numbers game with results and you know, what is probable, right, for anybody's future. So like for Natalie, she applies to enough schools, she'll get one callback, and that callback will be her next kind of decisive means of a journey, right? Kind of like, you know, like when the movie where like the guy has the dead end and then something kind of like happens and then like there's a new route and they go, oh, well, I guess I got to go down that way, right? Like Indiana Jones, right? Like something like he's in a fucking cave and like he gets trapped in like the cave, but then like there's like a little thing that opens up and it doesn't really look like he wants to go down that route, but it's the only route. So what are you going to do, right? Whereas like Natalie, it's like, well, you know what, you may be applying to all these schools and you will get into like one maybe, or, you know, maybe hopefully more, but you take that one route and you go, well, this is what I got. I'm going to make the most of it. And you never know what will happen down that route. You will never know, but that's what you wanted as well. It's the numbers game and you've won. If you've won a route in which you wanted to pursue, even if it's not the most favorable, life isn't about choosing the most favorable decisions. Life is about selecting and exploring and experiencing. Because as long as you keep moving, more experiences will always manifest in front of you.
Yeah, and I'm actually going to play with your example or your analogy for just a minute. So you were talking about how in Indiana Jones, you know, one way of getting to the end of the movie might close. You know what I mean? And then, you know, if you're too attached to that, then you go, oh man, that entrance was the entrance, man. You know, and it's like, yeah, but there's an adventure right over there. You know what I mean? Like there's a cave right there. Go check that cave out. And they're like, okay. And they go through the cave and they're like, and they can't stop thinking about the other tunnel that closed off and how upsetting it is that they missed it. And then what happens is they're missing all the stuff that they're being shown, all the clues and hints and, you know, different maps to other journeys that they're missing written on the cave walls because they're so worried and frustrated about the stuff they're thinking about now. It's like we miss opportunities when we set expectations like that on life. You know, if I say, and Natalie, you brought up a good point. I'm not going to criticize your actions, but I also would like to point out this idea and strap it onto your situation. When it comes to life problems, a lot of times we say, oh, this is what I need. If I just had this, you know what I mean? This would make things better. When it comes to planning out your life, you may set an expectation on a certain route and say, you know what, in order to get what I need, this would be the best school. And it may be true in the sense of like, in the sense that like maybe that school has a good history of this and that, but you never know where you're gonna end up. You know, maybe if you get denied from a certain school, but then get a call back from another school that actually their specialty isn't what you want to study, but you already have been looking into the stuff you're already studying. You might go there and you might learn something that puts two and two together. And boom, idea that generates so many possibilities in life. And it's like, the thing is, the only way you're going to like come across that is if you're like, you haven't closed yourself off, because people get so upset about the end of their future. You know, oh man, I've been married for this long and then this relationship just ended. And it's like, my life was planned out for me. Everything was going to work out. Now it's not. Because you thought that that's how your life was going to work out. You thought you expected life to work exactly how it was for you. There's a much bigger picture to reality. And I think that when it comes to a lot of things, you know, we even ignore a lot of information and data because of metaprograms. When it comes to certain issues in life, you know, maybe I say, this is what I need. I need a girlfriend. If I had a girlfriend, that'd be great, which it would. But but that's not what I'm going to say I need. I know that a long time ago, I used to make a lot of expectations about things that I needed. You know, I just need this. I need someone who can listen to me and understand me. I don't need that. I mean, I may think that in order to feel a certain way, I need to do that. But really, the fact that I have set that for myself and said, this is what I need in order to feel great, I am constantly convincing myself that because I don't have that, I can't be happy. You know, when a little kid, he sits there at the table and he's like, no, I don't like broccoli. I hate broccoli because it looks disgusting. And then someone goes, really? Here. And they give him broccoli and he actually likes it. And he goes, oh, wow. But then you see that he likes it. And then he goes, no, I don't like it. And he gets frustrated again, like, ew. You know what I mean? But you're like, no, you liked it. What are you talking about? You know what I mean? Like, in the same way, that's what we do. We go, oh, yeah. Like, this right here, this is going to make me happy. And then when we're actually enjoying ourselves, we start to go, oh, but I don't have that. Oh yeah, I'll always be sad. You know what I mean? It's like you're just killing your happiness and killing your enjoyment of the present moment and everything in life. When you get to a certain point of depression, a lot of people start modifying the life around them, saying, "Oh no, like it's probably just gonna suck." You know, if I do this, if I join that, you know, this might happen this way. You know what I mean? Life becomes a lot more toned down, a lot more weighty, and it's because instead of enjoying the present moment, setting expectations, saying, oh, this might happen. That idea sucks. I don't want to think about that. And even if I do think about that, so what? I'll enjoy it for what it is. It's a funny thought that came out of nowhere. You know, maybe a little bit depressing, but why not enjoy it as a joke? And I think that just when it comes to all of this, we do set expectations on things so much, and we distract ourselves from our own happiness, convincing ourselves that we need a certain thing to enjoy life. While you have people who, like Eckhart Tolle, who sat on a park bench for 3 years in intense happiness because he had completely released his ego. Like, wow. You know what I mean? So, sat on a park bench in the most intense state of happiness for 3 years. Doesn't have anything. And he's just beaming with joy and energy. And people come by, how? Why are you so happy? And he didn't even know. He didn't even know why he was happy. He was like, I don't know. It just happened one night. Like, you know, just these stories, it shows you that, like, there's a whole, like, just he's sitting there enjoying his whole life just on a freaking park bench with no money, no good food, you know, and yet he's having the time of his life. What the hell? You know what I mean? I'm sitting here like, oh, I need a girlfriend. Shut up.
He's totally fine where he is, you know. Which is really interesting.
What?
Like how, like, just like the change, like the difference in, like, perception.
Oh yeah. So I mean, when it ties back into MBTI and NLP, I mean, we all perceive things in a certain way, and things are processed certain ways. And
it's also like what you value too, because like an MBTI. It's all about what you value, as far as, you know, over time you've learned to value certain key aspects of yourself, like TE or FI or NE, right? Like, and you put these emphases over time and you end up preferring these functions over others, right? And it's interesting, like, how easily we can kind of succumb to really the data, how much the data really plays a role in our life, right?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, and when it comes to NLP, of course, you've got, you know, like, for example, an NI user may say, I'm going to build a meta program based off of this information because I recognize this pattern. While another type may say, like any user, may look at something and say, oh, well, it seems like the worst possibility is always chosen this way. So you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to set up a meta program for this. And it's like we install these belief systems and then we start to apply it in our perception of reality. And that's actually a good thing in some aspects, because there's so much data to take in that we need filters. And it's something they talk about.
Oh yeah, we couldn't just absorb everything. That would be overkill, because then we wouldn't know what to do with the information that we get, right? We have to be able to synthesize it somehow in a primary way, right?
Yeah.
Or else, you know, yeah.
Sorry, I was just gonna make a comment. You know what's really funny is it seems like I have filters that keep me from remembering basic things, basic things.
Isn't it weird though? Cause like I think about it and I think about like my normal everyday tasks. Like what if I really focused on remembering where everything is, right? What would that look like? What if I focused on, you know, objects instead of people more, right? Like just all these little differences in like what I actually do all day. Like what if I just, instead of doing all these, like everything at once, I limited myself to doing one thing at once and just saw how that happened, right? And it's crazy how we just kind of pick up these combination of experiences that we outline for ourselves, right? And like how that will really change the way that we do things, and especially over time, right? Like for a while, I tried using my left hand for a month instead of my right, and it was just very interesting, you know? Like how we can mindfully do that. We can actually adapt if we wanted to. You know, sometimes not by choice, right? But it's just so cool, like how in NLP, it's like, yeah, like you have all these programs, and then MBTI, it's like, yeah, you have all these functionalities.
Yeah. And right? I mean, I don't know, it's funny. Because, you know, me, you know me, I'm in my own world. But I seem to focus so much on the meaning of everything. that I lose.
Well, you know what? You have to remember, like, NI has its own purpose to you know, the applicability of your life, whereas it's really about experiencing, right? So NI keeps you from experiencing, right? You can contemplate all you want, but if you contemplate all the way to, like, you're 98 years old and you haven't done anything and moved an inch, like, what was the purpose of thinking all that, right?
And that's another thing is I've actually started to write recently. I have some notes that I've started on. When it comes to many aspects of my life, I've begun to write this stuff and even save some messages I've sent with some other people, because it's, you know, it's frustrating to me. Blake and I actually talked about this when he was over here. It's like, you know, let's just gather, you know, a few people with lots of ideas and thoughts and theories or whatever. And they think about this stuff all their life. Like, think about if Einstein had never really told anybody about his thoughts, or never posted a, you know, anything in a journal or anything like that, just never, ever told anyone, you know. And I think Isaac Newton kind of actually was pretty solitary about this stuff. But it's just like, if you never, he wrote, but, you know, a lot of the stuff he didn't like out there because of other people's claiming that it was their idea and just stuff like that.
Yeah.
But if you never release this stuff and let people know about this stuff, like, how is it ever going to contribute? It's almost like you're a walking footprint, in a sense that you're going to leave a mark before you die, and then you're just like, oh no, I'm just gonna let my footprint be buried in the ground, instead of like you know, instead of like slamming your head, your whole body down on the ground, creating a footprint in the ground. Like, I know this is a really weird visual. But when I saw it, I was like, oh, I don't know how I can recover from this one. But I mean, just the point is, like, you're supposed to leave a mark. And if you don't leave a mark and you just take that to your grave, you know, what was the point of spending all that time? Exactly what Daniel was saying. What is the point of spending all that time thinking? And even with experience, you know, you need experience in order to build conclusions and ideas. And I'm scared of a lot of experience. Like, I don't want to even be close to a part of it. And that's just me. There's something I see.
You just need an ESTP in your life.
There's still some stuff, man, that is just crossing the line. It is crossing the line. I'm not doing that.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'll watch from a distance and maybe learn something. But
you'll watch from a distance.
You don't even know what I'm talking about. But, yeah.
I think this is a good place where we can start wrapping this up if anybody has any questions.
Yeah, if you guys have questions, just go ahead and put it in the chat.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we have a lot of really cool topics that we covered today, and I want to make sure that you guys, you know, you guys get all your thoughts out. And if you didn't, you know, I threw out the link, by the way, to join us. So, I mean, you guys, for the next 4 minutes, you can hop on and talk to us if you feel like you want to, you know. But anyways, we're gonna be sitting idle, I guess, waiting for you guys to either ask a question or something.
All right, yeah, someone asked a question. JE said, do you love us? Let's talk about that for just a moment. When it comes to YouTube, a lot of the YouTubers will say, I love my fans. I don't know you guys. Now, the thing is, I'm not going to say I don't love and appreciate everything you guys do, because regardless of whether or not you're that one, you're that guy that goes to the comments and criticizes the hell out of me, I might pick something up. Maybe I'll even take a whole new strategy about how I should approach conflict. I don't know. When it comes to a lot of things, I've learned a lot. I've learned a lot about a lot of things. YouTube has been one of the most influential things in my life. It has given me an outlet where I don't feel like I'm being totally ripped apart for any of my ideas, which I really needed that at one point in my life. And I still love it, but I love the support that you guys give us. Just I read some of the comments and I don't even know how to respond, because it's like some of the stuff is so intense. I do read it, and I zone out because of just how much meaning it has. And then I don't even know how to respond. I'm like, fuck if I know how to respond to this person, but thank you so much. Like, I'll like your comment. Like, I don't even know what to say, you know? So like, you know, you guys definitely mean something to me. So yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think there was any more questions, was there?
No.
I mean, we can give him a few more seconds just in case, but then we're going to go ahead and sign off. So I really want to thank you guys for watching this video. I really enjoyed doing this live stream with Damon and then Daniel, because Damon was here for only a fraction of the time. I enjoyed doing this live stream with Daniel and just getting out some ideas, and actually gave me some new pictures and ideas to
think about. I never thought about that plot point world example until this chat, but that's pretty much how I would see it, right? Yeah, that's like the epitome. That's the epitome of NE versus NI, right? I'm on the ground floor, kind of checking off all these like plot points, and you're just like sitting in the sky going, huh, look at all these plot points. You know, it's a cool way of seeing it.
Well, guys, it doesn't look like we have any more questions. So thank you guys so much for watching. You should go check out our Slack. If you have questions for us personally, you can go check out the Slack link. Can you put the Slack link down below, Daniel?
The Slack link.
Yeah, in the chat. Yeah. I don't know where it's at, but
I have to find it because it's not like easiest place to find.
All right. Well.
No, I got it. I got it.
All right, so Daniel's going to put that in the chat. And that's, if you guys don't know, a lot of you guys are on Slack, but if you guys don't know, Slack is where we all talk as a family. A lot of us just have a lot of fun, and then some people are actually talking about theory and their ideas and their thoughts. And we have, oh, someone gave us a question. I didn't see it. I'm sorry.
Also, if you want to follow me or Trey specifically, we have our own channels. And For the most part,
I've converted completely over to
MBTV. Yeah,
but Daniel does have his own vlogs going on. So
yeah, I started up like a little vlog about my personal life and stuff. So if you want to see my beautiful face, you can go there and see it. And you know, me doing a lot of really, you know, whatever stuff, you know, going through things, talking about important topics, motivating you within it all somehow. So yeah.
All right. So we got a question. You talked about expectations. This is Brianna. You talked about expectations, not having them. What about realistic expectations? What about those that are self-loving nature? Do we draw a line?
Well, realistic expectations, just another really fancy way of saying standards.
Yeah, I mean, when you said that, I can see what you're talking about when it comes to having.
I know what she's talking about too. But at the end of the day, if somebody doesn't meet a realistic standard of yours, right? We're just going to call it what it is. It's a realistic standard, not an expectation. Then you know what's up, right? Then you know that you need to change something within that situation.
Well, thing is, when I think about this, I'm reminded. I'm going to give an extreme example. So just. Please
What's
be ready
the
for
extremes,
it.
Man?
Yeah, I'm going to try and revert it to a regular example, but I don't know if I can.
You have no chill.
So let's say that you see a news story online where some dude does something really messed up. Like, just imagine all the killings and stuff that goes on. And it's some really messed up stuff. And you ask yourself, is this person even, like, human? Like, what is it that makes this person do this stuff? And from all the stuff I've learned, from everything I've learned from MBTI, from primarily Enneagram, what I've learned is that these people are just in pain and they're looking to fix it and to emulate that pain somehow. And most of the time you go back and look at their parents, you know, the parents get interviewed after something happens like that. And the parents always say, oh no, my child, you know, he had a great childhood, you know, being raised up. And yet there's like documents and records of all of this, like all of these things that happened to the child. And, you know, it's like the child had to get removed from the family at one point and just like all this stuff. And you're like, did they really have a good childhood though? Like you said that, but did they really? And they may be trying to make up for this pain. So I'm not saying that their actions are admissible and just saying, okay, yeah, what they did is fine. I'm not saying that whatsoever. But I think that if someone does something like that because they're trying to remove pain, and then somebody else comes along and says, oh no, like you're such a horrible person. Like how can you imagine that they're taking that? You know what I mean? Like it's probably just making it worse. And I recognize this with myself in regular conversations I'd have with others. Seems like we're both just trying to make ourselves feel better. And one person would say something to me because they felt a certain way, and they would be trying to remove this pressure that they have on themselves, and I would invalidate it and push it back onto them. And I'm just like thinking later, I'm like, that was so wrong, because now this person feels even worse. And so we're all dealing with something. And so when you brought up the standards, I think when it comes to people, in our lives that come up to us and they have problems and they have certain things, standards that they have to meet, and in a way, it's almost like, you know, doing that and saying that they should be a certain way versus the way they already are. And I mean, truthfully, most of the things that they have wrong with them are the things that they do that are wrong or messed up or immoral or whatever. You know, when they do stuff that's like really messed up, inconsiderate, it's probably because they're just feeling so much pain, or maybe they don't even know. I used to get criticized for things that I didn't know. You know, why did you do this to this person? I didn't even know that was rude. You know what I mean? Like there's just a certain level where some people don't know, and some people are just feeling immense pain and don't know where else to place that pain. Because it's like you're feeling this pain and you want to get it off you. You want to get it off. It's just too much. So I'm going to deflect it. And when people deflect that pain, the pain is just, it's like a big pain circle jerk. I mean, everyone's feeling pain. That sucks. And so when it comes to standards and putting standards on people, I don't necessarily know what context you were speaking in, but I do know that, but I think that most of the time, instead of being upset because someone didn't meet your expectations or standards, it'd be more productive in the long run, or better, more considerate, to just love the person and in a place that you think they're not receiving much love, or something that they may be worried about. Because that's, I think a lot of times it's just them trying to get rid of this immense pain. So that's
you know, when you divide standards in half, you have respectability and integrity.
Right? Yeah, for sure.
All over.
Did you see what they said about your face, Daniel?
No, they say something about my face.
Yeah, they said, and Daniel does in fact have a beautiful face. Brianna said that she gets what I'm saying, and that we're all just human beings trying to do it the best with what we have. Can you love the person when they're hurting you? I think that you can. Because when you recognize why they're hurting you, it's usually out of pain. I saw a conversation specifically that I had with somebody where they were actually questioning my competency and pushing shame onto me. And I didn't want to feel that, and I didn't want to feel incompetent. It's actually a 5 thing that they desire feeling competent. So when that was pushed onto me, I directly invalidated it, used logic, and pushed it back onto them. And then later realized that, you know, really, I just, like, I was hurt and they were hurt. They were hurt, and I knew why they were hurt too. I knew why they were hurt. I knew the things that they felt insecure about at the time. And I recognize that probably came out because of that very thing. So they're trying to push out that pain, get it off of them. And all I did was make it worse. And I was trying to deflect the pain off of me because I felt pain. Instead, I can just forget about myself. And I can say, you know what? There is a much bigger thing going on here. And I can stop it. I can look at this person, and I can look them in the eyes, and I can say, you know, I really want to let you know that I appreciate this about you and this. When really they probably feel like they're not appreciated, or whatever it is that you feel, which you can't always guess it right, but if you have a suspicion that they feel unappreciated in a certain area or region, or that they don't feel competent, you can appreciate them for that very thing. And it's just more about appreciating what you have in front of you. And you can get out of that circle of pain. This is going a little bit longer than I wanted it to, but yeah, these are good questions.
They are good questions, but we do have to cut it short. I mean, it's not short, obviously, but if you have questions, guys, for Trey, feel free to reach out to him on Slack, where that's where his domain is, pretty much, if it's not live, or his email, and he will be able to surely, or just, you know, jump in here, and he'll be able to talk to you, right?
Yeah, you guys can, if you get on Slack, you can actually, I'll set up a Hangouts afterwards, if you guys like, on a Slack channel, and we can all talk about it if you guys would like, because I have some extra time. So you'd have to go to Slack though. So sign up for Slack if you're not already on it, and we can talk about this a little bit longer. But thank you guys so much. If you guys enjoyed this discussion, this talk, just give this video a like. I really appreciate you guys being here and commenting, and I appreciate Daniel for being here sharing his ideas too. This was a great call. I enjoyed it, and it may have gone a little bit off topic, but I think it was all really good stuff.
Yeah, every now and then I want to give you some intuitive data.
It was good stuff. It was good stuff.
Yeah. So thanks, guys, for coming on. We really do appreciate it. And we will see you next time.